pandemic took us by surprise, and our lives have been altered forever. For Christians, the situation we're in touches one of the most sensitive nerves of the faith. How do we account for horrible suffering, even innocent suffering, in a world where we believe God is both good and all-powerful? For this lecture series, we've invited some of our best professors to give us their best with the following instructions. Help us make sense of our world at the intersection of suffering, thoughtful Christian faith, and your own academic discipline. And so we present to you the George Fox Digital Pandemic Lectures on Suffering and Faith.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry day by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. These are the haunting opening words of Psalm 22, where David, the king of Israel, expresses what we so often feel. We cry out to God and we hear no answer. We plead for salvation and are met with silence. We are surrounded by deep darkness and night. We feel completely forsaken, forgotten, and alone. In our modern world, there are many reasons that may bring us to this existential despair. Our society is increasingly secular, which, let's face it, makes belief in God seem like a useless relic of the past. We face colossal challenges like climate change, racial injustice, and a global pandemic. We crave community and yet are isolated. We yearn for real relationships and yet are addicted to our phones and social media. We are drowning in anxiety, depression, and mental illness. And the list goes on. You can add whatever you suffer with to that list. Pope Benedict XVI compares modern faith to desperately clutching onto a piece of wood in open water. He writes, "Fastened to the cross, with the cross fastened to nothing, drifting over the abyss, the situation of the contemporary believer could hardly be more accurately and impressively described. Only a loose plank bobbing over the void seems to hold him up, and it looks as if he must eventually sink." Surely, we cannot be blamed when we ask, "Where are you, God, in all of this?" The first thing to say is that God does not shy away from the sorrows of the world. The scriptures are filled with examples of human suffering from Genesis to Revelation. You name it, it's there. Sickness, death, grief, sin, vice, evil. The full scope of human tragedy is almost embarrassingly on display. Indeed, it is strange, a strange miracle, that the Bible even includes the book of Job, which offers an unflinching examination of suffering and the problem of evil. It might not provide clear-cut answers to the question, why, but it affirms a fundamental truth that God wants us to voice our needs to Him. Again and again, the Bible encourages us to cry out to Him in our dereliction. We are to bring our whole heart to God in the midst of our trials. In the 1997 movie, The Apostle, Robert Duvall plays a troubled preacher named Sonny, who clings to God amid his various tribulations. In one famous scene, Sonny frantically exclaims his needs to God while pacing back and forth in his room in the middle of the night. The scene shifts to his mother receiving a phone call from a neighbor who says, "It sounds like you got a wild man over there and people need to get their sleep." His mother calmly replies, "Oh, that's Sonny. Sometimes he talks to the Lord. Sometimes he yells at the Lord. Tonight, he just happens to be yelling at him." And then she takes the phone and hangs up on the neighbor and smiles to herself. Whether whispering or yelling, God invites us not to bury or ignore our suffering, but rather to offer it to Him in sincere, heartfelt prayer. It is in the book of Psalms, especially, that the Bible shows the whole range of human emotion and encourages us to engage God with all of ourselves. It is here that God gives us the language to speak our hearts to Him. Throughout the history of Christianity, believers have extolled the Psalms as one of the most beautiful and powerful books in all of Scripture. The reformer Martin Luther saw the Psalms as a little Bible that contained all the wisdom of doctrine and majesty of prose of the rest of Scripture. He particularly loved the way the Psalms lay bare the full variety of human experience, from fear and anxiety to laughter and joy. Another theologian would say it is an anatomy of the soul. Luther concludes his praise of the Psalms by stating, "The sum of all is that if you wish to see the Holy Christian Church depicted in living colors and given a living form, in a painting in miniature, then place the book of Psalms in front of you. You will have a beautiful, bright, polished mirror which will show you what Christianity is. Nay, you will see your own self in it, for here is the true know thyself, by which you can know yourself, as well as the God who created all things." One theologian who knew suffering well and appreciated the Psalms in the midst of it was the 20th century German theologian and pastor Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Bonhoeffer is famous for his resistance against the Nazis during the Second World War, which eventually cost him his life. He wrote books which are now considered spiritual classics, such as The Cost of Discipleship and Life Together. You might have read one of these books in a Bible study or with your church. What is less known about Bonhoeffer is his commitment to the Psalms and the role they played while he was wrestling with these extraordinary difficulties that he faced. From Hitler's rise to power in 1933 to Bonhoeffer's untimely execution in 1945, Bonhoeffer turned to the Word of God for truth in a world filled with lies. He believed that only the Word of God would provide the tools necessary to learn an unrelenting form of discipleship which could stand up to the forces of the Nazi regime. From 1935 to 1937, as the clouds of war were forming on the horizon of Europe, Bonhoeffer started an illegal seminary where he could train young seminarians through intensive study of the Bible. It was in this context that Bonhoeffer wrote the book, The Prayer Book of the Bible, a brief but compelling reflection on the Psalms as a prayer book for Christians, really as an instruction manual for how to pray. In it, Bonhoeffer argues that we can only pray the Psalms if we understand first that Jesus prayed through the Psalms himself. Bonhoeffer claims, "This is what Jesus Christ wants. He wants to pray with us. We pray along with Christ's prayer, and therefore may be certain and glad that God hears us. When our will, our whole heart, enters into the prayer of Christ, then we are truly praying. We can only pray in Jesus Christ, with whom we shall also be heard." Bonhoeffer goes on to argue that we must read the Psalms Christologically, that is, always seeing them as referring to Christ. The Psalms contain within them the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. In this way, the whole Psalter, like all of Scripture, points to Jesus. What then do we learn about suffering from the Psalms? Bonhoeffer classifies the 150 prayers into major categories, including life, salvation, the church, and the law. It is in the Psalms of Lament that we find the raw prayers of the brokenhearted. For Bonhoeffer, Jesus Christ experienced all of the suffering of humanity when he was on earth. This is why only Jesus, the man of sorrows, can help us no matter what anguish we might face. We may come to doubt God's goodness through our trials, but we must continually wrestle with God. As Bonhoeffer puts it, "The one who suffers sets out to battle against God for God, holding fast to his promises when they seem impossible, when it seems like God himself is against you. Only from this intense struggle can the Christian come to fully trust in God. In Bonhoeffer's words, trust in God without Christ is empty and without certainty. Indeed, it can only be another form of self-trust. But whoever knows that God has entered into our suffering in Jesus Christ himself may say with great confidence, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And here Bonhoeffer is quoting that famous verse from Psalm 23. Bonhoeffer said it well in a letter he would write later from prison. The Bible directs people toward the powerlessness and the suffering of God. Only the suffering God can help. From this, we learn the most basic and greatest lesson of Christianity, the promise and the treasure of the most holy gospel. Jesus Christ has not left us in our suffering. We are not abandoned, forgotten, or alone. Much to the contrary, Christ has entered into our suffering and knows all of our woes as God who is with us and for us. It is none other than the crucified Savior who says from the cross those lines we heard at the beginning of this lecture. With a crown of thorns, with nails in his wrists, with the weight of the world's misery on his shoulders, and the groaning of the cosmos surrounding him, Christ said, my God, why have you forsaken me? This is the mystery of faith, that the one who has come will come again, and when he comes, he will bear the scars of humanity in his body. In Psalm 22, David goes on to say, I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. And stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted. And he has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before you. For kingship belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the prosperous of the earth eat and worship. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, even the one who could not keep himself alive. Posterity shall serve him. It shall be told of the Lord to the coming generation. They shall come and proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, that he has done it. In France, there's a striking painting called the Eisenheim altarpiece. It was completed during the 16th century for a monastery that specialized in hospital work, particularly ministering to those suffering from the plague or skin diseases such as leprosy. Christ is depicted as himself consumed with illness, his body riddled with warts, his complexion ghostly, his hands contorted in twisted hands aimed heavenward. Behold, this is the Christ who has entered our pandemic, who is infected with the virus, who bears within himself the loneliness of quarantine, the loss of physical touch, the yearning of the elderly and the poor, the endless waiting for a cure. And yet, in that suffering, he is our only hope, God with us. When all this is over, not only the pandemic, but all of our suffering, not only our personal laments, but the hardship of the whole world throughout history, we will truly say with the psalmist of the Lord Jesus Christ, he has done it. Amen.
You just heard from Dr. Javier Garcia, who holds a PhD in theology from Cambridge University. He's the director of our university's honors program and author of Recovering the Ecumenical Bonhoeffer, Thinking After the Tradition. We have more lectures in this series. Check them out on our YouTube page for George Fox Digital.